American Baptist. Would you please stand for the entrance of our honorees, Pastor Patrick and First Lady Diane Parks? Let's give them a round of applause. Once again, welcome. It's a privilege and an honor to stand before you this afternoon. At this time, would you please stand for the reading of God's Word? And our scripture this afternoon is going to be coming from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40. And when we get there, we're going to drop down and read verses 30 and 31. Once again, it's Isaiah, chapter 40. Verses 30 and 31, and we'll be reading from the King James Version. And it reads as such, "Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." Amen. I read for you Isaiah chapter 40, verses 30 and 31. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy word. Amen. You may be seated.
Shall we pray? Most holy, we come into your presence this evening, thanking you for this day. And Master, we ask right now that you be in our midst. Lord, as we celebrate this one-year anniversary for our pastor, Pastor Park, and later Di. Later Diane, Lord, we thank you for standing with him and being a part of this ministry. And Lord, I ask right now that you continue to look down on him, Lord, and give him the words that he can feed your sheep. Lord, I ask that you right now that you continue to minister to his heart. And Lord, also minister to our heart. That the words that be preached, Lord, let us be more receptive to them. That we be able to go down that path, Lord, and be able to stand in your midst. And Lord, I ask right now, Lord, that you look around in this fellowship right now. Whatever someone might need, Lord, we ask that you to touch their heart right now, Lord. Someone might be in need of a spiritual blessing. And we ask right now, Lord, that you pierce that heart and you bless in a mighty way. And Lord, as we go forth in this program, Lord, we ask whatever said and done, let it come from heaven. And Lord, the word can be spoken this evening, Lord. We ask that you feed your sheep. Lord, feed your sheep. Master, this is my prayer. Lord, this is my prayer. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon, Second Baptist. Come on, this is a celebration. Good afternoon, Second Baptist. All right, my name is Deacon Andrew Wiggs, and I have the honor and the privilege to be your master of ceremonies for this great occasion. We are celebrating the first anniversary of Reverend Parks and Lady Diane Proggs. Come on, give it up. Because you know what kind of year we have been through, and God put the right person in the place at the right time to make us get through, as I said, endure, right? And we are here to celebrate them and Second Baptist, and we appreciate everyone who was able to join us, all of Second Baptist family and friends. We are looking to have a spiritual, enlightening, celebratory time because they said there is no party like a Holy Ghost party, and a Holy Ghost party don't stop. All right, so we're going to go ahead and get this started off. We're going to kick it off with our music ministry, and they are going to bless us because you've already heard from them again once. Twice, they're going to just bless us with the song, and then after that, we're going to have Sister Lynn Boyd, who is going to acknowledge our visitors. Amen. Thank you.
Oh, Good afternoon, Second Baptist, and also to our visitors and friends, good afternoon as well. Welcome to our first pastor anniversary celebration for Patrick E. Parks and our First Lady Diane Parks, and congratulations to both of you. It is now my pleasure at this time to announce visitors to our service, and I ask that the visitors, when I call your name, to please stand. And I also ask that the audience please hold your applause until all the visitors have been recognized, if you wouldn't mind. We have with us today our chief of police for the city of Elgin, Anna Lally. We have Gene Crum, Jr., president of Judson University. We have Dr. David Sam, president of Elgin Community College. Now, are there any visiting pastors and ministers from other churches that are attending today? Would you please stand at this time?
Amen.
All righty. And also, our SBC associate ministers, would you also please stand at this time? Amen. And are there any other visitors who are visiting with us for the first time today? If there are, would you please stand at this time? All righty. Now, on behalf of Pastor Patrick E. Parks, Mrs. Diane Parks, and all of the members of Second Baptist Church of Elgin, I welcome you warmly and with open arms. Please enjoy the service today. Sing along with us all the hymns, as you realize hymns have endured the storm and kept us anchored in Christ. Praise God as divine movement dances, and be blessed by the sermon of our guest speaker. You may even want to take notes. And may you leave with the joy of the Lord in your minds and hearts, renewing your strength, searing high, soaring high on wings like eagles, running and not growing weary, walking and not fainting. Have a wonderful afternoon.
All right, can we give our distinguished visitors one more round of applause? So if you know anything about Second Baptist, you know that we are community-minded. We are rooted in the community of Elgin, and we support Elgin. And Pastor Parks has come in, and he has stood on the foundation that we have set up, and he's continued to expand on that. So we have some of our community leaders who want to just give a tribute to the pastor. First up, we have the Chief of Police, Ann Laley.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Anna Laley. I'm the chief here in Elgin. First, I want to say thank you to Pastor Parks and First Lady for inviting me. It's an honor to be standing up here and just to say a few words. I met Pastor Parks probably about a year ago, and I asked to come and meet him here at the church. And I think he was a little surprised that the chief of police wanted to meet him. So we've had a great relationship with Second Baptist, and I wanted to meet him, and I wanted to say welcome in person. And I also wanted to let him know that the Elgin Police Department is very, very different, and we're not a perfect department, but we try every single day. And so I wanted to make sure that he knew that, and I also wanted to make sure that he knew that this was his home, and we were here for him and here for everyone here. And so I just want to say congratulations to you and to the First Lady. This is an awesome event. I'm happy to be here. Much love to you, much success, and thank you, everyone, for having me. Thank you.
All right, next up we have Dr. Gene Crum, president of Judson University.
Good afternoon, Second Baptist community. Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you again on behalf of my wife, Cindy, myself, the faculty, staff, and students of Judson University, as well as the Board of Trustees. We extend our congratulations and appreciation to Diane and Patrick for the role that they serve in your church. You know, Second Baptist and Judson University have a history that has been intertwined, certainly for all of our 9 years at Judson, but going back even further than that. Members of Second Baptist have been trustees, alumni board members, spiritual council members, faculty, staff, students. I'm pretty confident that the first mask we ordered from Judson University during COVID came from a member of your congregation and their company. So we have shared a lot of time together. Cindy has spent time bringing Judson to be a part of your women's ministry. And we feel like at Judson University, that's a lot like what the kingdom of heaven's going to look like. Brothers and sisters in Christ working alongside of each other, sharing the commonalities that they have, but still doing the distinct work in the communities that they're called to serve and be a part of. As you all probably know, the single most popular chapel service at Judson University every year is when the choir comes and sings and performs at Judson. It's not even close. You can give your round of applause, absolutely. So whether we're learning, whether we're preaching, whether we're serving, or whether we're singing alongside together, it's very special. Even more special now for us at Judson University because of Patrick being a graduate of the institution. And in fact, probably the strongest relationship is not with me as the president and Patrick as your senior pastor. It's probably with my bride, Cindy, because she got to know Patrick when he was finishing his degree and they were in the same building from time to time. So, Patrick, Diane, congratulations. We're extremely proud of you all. We enjoy loving and seeing you on campus. Thank you for ministering to our students and our faculty and our staff with your church community that you share. We look forward to a long and continued partnership with you. May God bless you. Thank you.
All right, and next we have our own president of the Elgin Community College, Dr. David Song.
Greetings, Pastor and Lady Di. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, faculty, staff, administrators, and all the students at Elgin Community College, welcome to this community. Elgin Community College has had a long-standing relationship with Second Baptist. It continues today, and it will continue tomorrow. And we implore you to take advantage of all the opportunities that exist at the college. You are now a full member of the Elgin Community College community. You live in South Elgin, and so you pay taxes to us. And so take advantage of everything there. So welcome to our community. We look forward to working with you well into the future. Thank you and congratulations.
All right, so I said this was a celebration, so we have a treat for you guys. This group of young ladies have been ministering at Second Baptist for a while, and every time they perform, they touch your hearts and they touch your souls. So be prepared to have the Spirit move you as we bring forth our own divine movement. Let's give it up for those young ladies again. So I'm going to give a plug for the Divine Movement. So this is probably, I don't know, this is generation five of the Divine Movement. These young ladies are awesome. I believe the first generation have now graduated out. They got college, they got houses, jobs. So this ministry is doing wonderful things in developing these young ladies and getting them prepared for the world. And that's what Second Baptist does. And so we appreciate that, and we appreciate the pastor being able to continue on that legacy that's going on. So right now, I believe we have a video tribute. Amen, amen, amen. Before we move on, I would be remiss if I didn't give a special shout out to the audiovisual team. They are making it work. Tributes and Second Baptist is not going to show our love. So we have a couple special tributes for you. To move that forward, we want to introduce Sister Lucy Scruggs.
Good afternoon, church family and friends. All praises and glory to God for this day. I consider it a privilege as well as an honor to be allowed to offer a few words of tribute to our First Lady, Sister Diane Parks. This is on behalf of the Anniversary Committee and the women of Second Baptist Church of Elgin. Due to the COVID situation, we have not been able to greet you as some of us would have liked to on Sunday morning, like with a warm, smiling hello and a hug on the Sunday mornings, even though we are smiling behind that mask when we wave at you. When we thank God for our pastor, we must give thanks for two. Because when God sent us Pastor Parks, God also sent us you. Matter of fact, we now know that you were the catalyst that God used to get Pastor Parks here. Let me keep it real for a minute. Sister Diane, we see you. We see the beautiful, gorgeous outfits. We see the cute, awesome hairstyles. And you know we check out the shoes. But most importantly, we see you. We see your humble spirit as you sit quietly in support of your husband. We see your love for God through your display of praise and worship. We see that you also endured the storms this past year, staying anchored in the Word of God. As women, especially Black women, we all consider ourselves queens. But we know that you are not just a queen. You are a pastor's wife. The wife of a pastor is no ordinary role. You see, it's not for the jealous or timid soul. Her husband she has to share with the whole congregation as she humbly accepts his intense dedication. In loneliness, she kneels to God to seek consolation. God bless the pastor's wife. On behalf of the anniversary committee and the women of SBC, we honor you this day. They even made me wear a hat. And we'd like to present you with this lovely bouquet of flowers that's sitting right in front of you, so be sure to take those with you to show our appreciation to you. Being our First Lady is a blessing that is not unspoken. May God continue to bless and keep you as you stand alongside the man of God with love, support, encouragement, and faith, setting an example of the true commitment to him and the work he has been called to do. Sister Diane, know that at SBC, you are surrounded by a sisterhood that prays for you, loves, and appreciates you. Happy anniversary, and to God be the glory for this day.
Good morning, good evening, Second Baptist and family and friends. I have the honor of being able to make a tribute to my mother and father and pastor and First Lady. I just made the disclaimer real quick. This was all Dr. Evans' idea. She pulled me off in the corner, and knowing her history, I know she was a principal, so I said, uh-oh, what did I do? But she pulled me off to a corner, and she asked me if I would do this tribute to my mother and father, and I believe it was only right to do this for my mother and father. First, I'd like to speak about my father and my pastor and my friend. You know, like I said before, he's been there my whole life. He's been a consistent influence in my life, and I believe he's the biggest reason I am the younger man I am today. And he has continued to instill in me great lessons of how to be a young man and how to conduct myself and how to be a man of God. And I have the utmost confidence that wherever I go in this life, whatever I do in this life, it will be all because of him and what he's instilled in me. So, Father, Pastor, I thank you. You have done a marvelous job leading this church, and you have led these people, these great people, in a tremendous way, especially during the pandemic. It was many sleepless nights. It was many nights where I can hear you working downstairs, 12 o'clock in the morning, working on a sermon. And you continue to work, and you continue to put in the time, and you continue to give your absolute best. So I want you to know that doesn't go unnoticed by me. And I know sometimes I can be a little spoiled, and I know sometimes I can act like stuff don't matter. But I want you to know I'm grateful and I'm thankful for what you not only do for me, but what you do for my church family. And to my mother, I can't forget about my mother now, y'all. My I tell y'all, my mother, she's precious, you know. She's precious, and she has really come out of her shell this past year. I mean, I've really seen my mother in a new light, and she has really adapted, you know. My mother, she's not much of a talker, as you guys know, and she really come out of her shell, especially with the sister circle, and she has really just done a marvelous job, and even though I've helped her out with a lot of her slides with the sister circle. it was, you know, many, many days where she'd be like, Josh, you an AP student, so check my grammar for me. Make sure my comma's correct, make sure my quotations are correct. And I'd be obedient child. I'd be, okay, mama, I got you. And but no, in all seriousness, though, she has done a marvelous job supporting her husband and still supporting her family and still working and still being the best first lady she can be. So I want you to know, Mom, I love you and I thank you. And I know I'm gonna be going off to college soon, both of you, but as I leave both of you soon, I want you to know my prayers continue to always be with you both. Continue to lead these people, continue to do the work of God, continue to do the work of Christ until he's soon to return. And I love both of you. Love you.
Come on. Let's keep it going for that special young man. All right, and you know when you got a special young man, you have some special parents standing behind him, so congratulations. All right, so we are going to continue this celebration. We have another special tribute, musical tribute for Sister Crystal Bonner. So I just want to say this, because after Crystal Bonner comes up, the pastor himself is going to come up and introduce the guest speaker. But you know how we say that God has you equally yoked. And I'm going to agree, the first lady knows how to get down, but she is equally yoked. Wait till you see the pastor come up here. He is clean. He got a mad sock game going on. So God knows what he's doing when he puts you with your partner. All right, so we're next going to move forward with our musical tribute.
Good afternoon, everybody. Happy anniversary, y'all. Change me, oh God. Make me more like you. Wash me through and through. Just create in me a clean heart so that I may worship you. Change me, oh God. Make me more.
From the inside.
Change.
anybody, is that your testimony? Yes. From the inside, everybody say,
change me.
Oh, say,
change me.
Whatever's not like you, Lord, I need you to do.
Change me.
I need you to do.
Change
me, Lord.
Change.
God for his goodness and his mercy towards each of us on this afternoon. What a prized privilege and a holy honor it is to stand before you on this afternoon with the task of presenting our guest speaker for the hour. As you read the program, let me just say, first of all, that words fail to adequately capture the impact that this mighty man of God has made on the African-American community in particular and the kingdom of God collectively. Also, I thank God that as I go back in the Rolodex of my memory, it seems like every significant moment in my life as it relates to ministry, Dr. Hatch has been right there to share them with me. We share the anniversary of when we were ordained. We were ordained on the same day. In different years, of course, his father served as pastor for many years at the Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church. And now, as I prepare to celebrate this first year of pastoral ministry at this great church called Second Baptist, he was so gracious enough to agree to come and share the word with us on this occasion. I thank God for him. I thank God for the behavior and how he models what it means to be a humble, holy God-called vessel. And so, after the choir renders their selection, the next speaking voice that you will hear will be the proud pastor of the New Mount Pilgrim Missionary Baptist Church on the wonderful west side of Chicago. He is none other than the Reverend Dr. Marshall Elijah Hatch, Sr. Say amen as the choir comes.
Just in case. The bills may roll, the breakers may dash. I shall not sway because he holds me fast. So dark the day, clouds in the sky. I know I'm all right because Jesus is nigh.
Let's bless the Lord with another hand clap of praise, who is worthy of the praise. We greet you in the matchless name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is worthy of the praise. And what a blessing it is to be here with Pastor and Lady Parks on their first anniversary. What a great occasion. Don't they look lovely? Don't they look beautiful? I tell you, they look so young and vibracious. If I didn't know any better, I think they was going to prom. But certainly we thank God for this wonderful team. Thank God for Pastor Parks, who has prepared himself and who is as earnest and passionate about the gospel of Jesus Christ as anyone you will find anywhere. And so we consider it a privilege that you asked us to come and invited us to come and share this time with you. We've seen your high moments over the year. And I want you to know, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither can you imagine what God has in store for you just because you love him. Amen. And so God is to be praised. Thank you again. And then again, Lady Parks, thank God for you. Thank you for your hospitality. And of course, we don't have to ask much about your character and the internal, because when we saw this young man, when we heard him speak about his parents, that just about told you everything you need to know about the Parks family. And so what a blessing it is. We've got two sons. I was hoping I could get that on videotape to show them what to say next year at my anniversary. Just verbatim, just say it just like that. But put my name where he say his daddy name, put my name there and you'll be all right, you know. So that's what I want to happen. Amen. Thank God for my wife of 37 years here. So 38, I knew that. Amen. 38 years. Sister Priscilla's in the house, and we thank God. Thank you for having us. And then our oldest daughter, Sister Joyce, here, and our youngest grandchild. And we got five of those, and then my sister, and then my sisters-in-law. We're so delighted to be here today in this great city of Elgin and, of course, in this historic Second Baptist. I tell you, I feel like I'm on holy ground remembering 1866, just 1 year after the Civil War, and this church is founded by people who escaped the terrorism of slavery. And then this incredible part of our state, this state which was a bastion of abolition And all around us, whether we know it or not, there is Underground Railroad all around us. This is where folks who came and believed they were doing the Lord's will. This is John Brown on yesterday. There was an anniversary of Harper's Ferry commemoration. And so I consider it a high honor to be at the Second Baptist Church, one of the great churches in the whole United States of America, with an incredible history, of achievement, and an incredible history of uplift, of knowing what it means to somehow use what you got till you get what you need and to keep on moving. Amen. And so this is a great time in history. And then, of course, with Pastor Parks, the Lord always takes us higher and higher. And so thank you so much for allowing us to be here. I'm going to just move quickly into a scripture that we will lift up today in the Old Testament book called the Chronicles. And I want to just preach from the theme of chosen. Amen. Chosen. When you look at this text in Chronicles, this reoccurring word, 1 Chronicles chapter 28, beginning at verse 4, and this is what the word says. Howbeit the Lord God of Israel chose me, David talking, before all of the house of my father to be king over Israel, for he has chosen Judah to be a ruler, and of the house of Judah, the house of my father, and among the sons of my father, he liked me to make me king over all Israel. Verse 5, and of all my sons, for the Lord has given me many sons, he have chosen Solomon, my son, to sit on the throne of the kingdom of the Lord over Israel. And he said to me, Solomon, thy son, he shall build my house and my courts. I have chosen him to be my son. I will be his father. Moreover, I will establish his kingdom forever if he be constant to do my commandments and my judgments as at this day. Now, therefore, in the sight of all of Israel, the congregation of the Lord, and the ordinance of our God, keep and seek for all the commandments of the Lord your God, that you may possess the good land and keep it for an inheritance for your children forever. Verse 9, and thou, Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father, and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind, for the Lord searcheth all hearts and understand all imagination and thoughts. If thou seek him, he will be found of thee. But if thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever. Verse 10, take heed now, for the Lord hath chosen you to build a house for the sanctuary. Be strong and do it. Verse 10, then David gave Solomon his son the pattern of the porch and of the houses thereof and of the treasuries thereof and of the upper chambers thereof and of the inner parlors thereof and of the place of the mercy seat. And the church said, amen. Amen. Thank you for standing. Our theme is chosen. God, we thank you for this time of sharing. We pray to anoint by your spirit now. Bless us. Bless this house. Let your word be lifted up. Let your name be glorified. And now we ask every blessing. Thank you now for this servant of God. And we pray you would bless this work of this team. In Jesus' name, amen. And bless God. And so our theme lifting up just on this evening is chosen. And just reading the text, you know, when you look at the reoccurring phrase of church, of phrase of chosen and choice, it is clear that the theme of this passage is that God makes choice of some people over others. And you look at verses 4 and 5, David says, listen, I've been chosen. In fact, our tribe has been chosen over the other tribes. And of our tribe, the house of Jesse, my father, has been chosen. And then out of all of my brothers, God chose me to be the king over Israel. God chooses people. And then he says to Solomon, of course, now Solomon, you've been chosen. God wants to use you to build this house, this Yahweh temple, this tabernacle, this palace for the Lord our God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God is going to use you, not me, my hands are bloody, but God is going to use you to build this house of prayer. And so God chooses people for an assignment, a work, a responsibility to serve in their generation. And I want to be clear that, listen, when God chooses who God chooses, the choice God makes is based upon certain qualities and characteristics that God discerns on the inside. In other words, it's been said, of course, of David in the scripture. Listen, man looks at the outer appearance, but God looks at the heart. And I've been careful to say God chooses people. And to say he chooses men, he chooses women too. I wish I had a witness right there. He chooses people too. I could have talked about how God chose Ruth for her loyalty, or Sarah for her faith, or Esther for her courage, or Deborah for her insight and leadership, or Mary for her character. God chooses Fannie Lou Hamer, Phyllis Wheatley. God chooses people based on what God sees on the inside. Solomon demonstrates here some of what God sees in the present, in the text, and some of it is aspirational, but in other words, some of the qualities he has immediately, some of them will be and can be developed over time. In other words, whatever qualities that you don't have, God is able to cultivate them. God is able to develop them. God is able to nurture and disciple. You don't have to be all of that. You hear what I'm saying? You know, I've shared, we've got two daughters, and, you know, one time I had to kind of just kind of fess up when they said, you know, Daddy, we want a man like you. I said, well, you need to ask your mama how long it took for me to come this far wherever I am. You won't find it ready-made, amen. But God is able to develop and to cultivate and to nurture and to disciple us if we're willing to grow. And that's what I believe this pandemic season is all about. It's about us learning to follow Christ closer. Whenever we have a season of testing, it'll be just like this season, just like this pandemic. You'll notice that some people are going to be driven and some people are going to be drawn. In other words, in the season of testing, a lot of people, insincere in their faith, decent churchgoers, look like they were really up to something, and you're going to find they're falling away in the pandemic. Some of them will deny the faith and turn away. But for those who are sincere about their faith, the same pandemic will draw us closer to Christ. The same season of pandemic for us is a season of discipleship. I mean, I just have to admit, I'm closer to God in the pandemic than I was before the pandemic. I'm praying more. Can I be honest? I'm nicer to people. Don't you look at me like you're not nice sometimes. But I found myself in a deeper spiritual place and to realize that this has an upside and a downside. And so God uses it to develop us. This text has at least four qualities that God looked for in Solomon when God chose Solomon for his generation. First of all, his distinctiveness. Secondly, his diligence. Thirdly, his determination, and then lastly, his obedience or attention to detail. His capacity to follow detail. Now notice verse 4 and 5 again that we read. It says again that David among his brothers was an outstanding. He was distinctive. He was different. And then Solomon, among all of David's sons, David says, I had many. Out of all of them, there was something distinctive about Solomon. Yes, Solomon was different. In other words, he stood out. And normally when God chooses somebody, he chooses somebody who is willing to stand out instead of just fit in. Because everybody can follow a crowd, but it takes a distinctive character to learn how to walk sometime by yourself. And if you want to get God's attention, learn how to stand out. Learn how to dare to be different. Learn how to walk to the beat of a different drummer. Learn how to be a standout and upstanding and outstanding in your generation. And God has a way of choosing people. God says in verse 6, he says, listen, I've chosen him to be my son, talking about Solomon. In other words, I want him to be a reflection of me in a fallen world. I don't want somebody that looks like everybody else, that thinks like everybody. I want somebody that I can call my son, who will be my reflection. He chooses him because of his distinctiveness. Secondly, in verse 7 and 8, Solomon is called to be diligent in studying the word and doing the word. He said, Solomon, thy son, who will build my house, for I have chosen him to be my son as father. Verse 7, moreover, I will establish his kingdom forever if he be constant to do my commandments and my judgments. In other words, I have called him to be a one who not only studies the word, but who lives it, who practices it. I've called him to study and to do, because a whole lot of people study. And then some folk can quote, but they just can't do what they quoted. He said, I've called him, listen, to study the word and to live by the wisdom of the word. In verse 8, he said, therefore, in all of the sight of Israel, of the congregation of the Lord, and in the audience of our God, to seek all of the commandments of the Lord your God, that you may possess the land. Listen, I've called him to be performative. I need somebody that will demonstrate what it looks like, that the word works if you work it. And your fruit will be the evidence that you've manifested the word. Be constant and diligent, and Solomon, you will bear fruit. He says he sees in him, look, his distinctiveness, his diligence. And then thirdly, in verse 9 and 10, Solomon, somewhere down there, God saw a determination. Look at what he says in verse 9. Thou, Solomon, my son, know that the God of thy father, know the God of thy father, serve him. Listen, with a perfect heart and a willing mind. For the Lord knows the hearts and the mind, and he searches them, and he can see how sincere and how determined you are. In other words, he's telling him, listen, I want you, Solomon, to take hold of this task. I want you to grasp it. I want you to let it arrest you, and you arrest it. And listen, he says in verse 10, take heed now, for the Lord your God have chosen you to build the house. Be strong and do it. Do it. God calls on Solomon to have this inner drive, this inner determination. His father challenges him, listen, to have that something on the inside that drives you. It's interesting. There's a conversation going on among particularly educators, but social scientists in general, because of, you know, it's just difficult to explain how some people can come up in the same environments as other people, and other people are overtaken, but then there are others who kind of come up and come through, and the social scientist is trying to figure out what do they have on the inside that made them different. And it just seemed like, you know, with the resources that they have in their research, that they should have been able to come up with a better word. But can I tell you the word that they're kind of bandying around in these academic circles? They said it's called grit. Not grits. But grit, meaning that something on the inside that constitutes an inner drive, not grits, not something that you eat, but grit, something that eats you on the inside where you don't give up until you get the job done. Amen. I'm a living witness. Grit will bring you out the projects. When folk are dying all around you, this little extra something, he says to him, be strong. That, you know, that grit, that is that thing that motivates people to succeed in spite of their limitations, in spite of opposition, in spite of persecution, in spite of obstacles. And you can't say that it is not in you because your ancestor had it. Down in slave quarters, every one of you is a survivor of the Middle Passage. There's something in you that conducted underground railroads and engaged in great migration. There's something in us that if you look for it, you'll find it. It's a faith, the text says. Literally in verse 9, his father says to him, David says to Solomon, know the God of your father. In other words, what he's saying to you, listen, I'm pouring into you. I want to help you to succeed. I'm doing my task, my role. I'm serving my generation, and sooner or later it'll be your turn. And what I want you to do, though, I need you to know the Lord your God. In other words, you need to know the Lord for yourself. Come a time, you have to know the Lord, the God of your father, and he's got to become your God. Yahweh, you need to have a personal experience with the Lord for yourself. You need to know Jesus for yourself. You need to have your own relationship with God. He says, know the Lord and serve him. Listen to this, with a perfect heart and a willing mind. In other words, the text teaches that if you look closely, that's probably where the grits come from. It's when the head and the heart are in alignment. So you got to get it right now, because, you know, folk now, they only celebrate being smart. I mean, their phone is smart. I mean, just everything. I mean, they're just smart. And they think that that's what really constitutes quality humanity, that you know, the smartest, the slickest, the craftiest, the one who, you know, is cerebral, who lives in the schemes of and the devices of the mind. But what David is teaching his son, no, you need to have the heart and the head in alignment. That's where your grit is going to come from. You see, smart is good, but those of us that got children know that every one of them is different, and you live long enough, you find out it's not the smartest one that's going to do the most. It's the hardest worker. The one who puts their heart and their head into the engagement. And somehow, when you mix the head and the heart, faith somehow is created, and you're able to overcome all of the obstacles. He said, listen, know the Lord for yourself. You know, have a perfect heart, or have a heart that is folk. Be for real. Be authentic and genuine. Be earnest and honest. You know, it's not quite the same thing. Be a person who is committed to doing the right thing in the right way. And then God will give you the powers of imagination. And when that heart and that head is lined up, you can get it done. You're going to have obstacles. It's not going to be easy. But you'll have a grit that's produced when intelligence is not enough. Amen. Some of y'all, you know, you have to tell the truth. You didn't even really qualify for the job you got. Amen. You're just a hard worker. You didn't have the degree, the credential. Come on and help me, somebody here. Amen. But you did your best, and you were honest, and you were trustworthy, and you were dependable, and you were punctual. And folk knew that if they wanted it done, to get you to do it. He says to Solomon, be strong and do it. No excuses. You can do this. Are you here with me today? And you know, we ought to just be honest. We've put Patrick Parks in quite a situation. I mean, to have your first year in a pandemic. I mean, your first year pastoring. I mean, you know, you trying to figure things out, and you're in the midst of a global pandemic where you don't even know if you're supposed to ask people to come to church. Figure that out. Pastor through that. Are you here with me today? And you can see what a miracle church is, because listen, I've been a pastor since 1985. I started when I was probably about 5 years old. No, I was older than that, I'm sorry. Don't tell no story in the pulpit. But since 1985, if anybody would have told me that a church could survive without people showing up in the pews every Sunday, putting money in a basket, I would be wondering how. But you know yourself, God has made a way out of no way. God has exceeded with abundance. God has done exploits. And we're still here. Can I tell you how we're still here? In Jesus' name, we're still here. I can do all things when I know where my strength comes from, through Christ who gives me strength. David says, listen, this is going to be a hard assignment. This is going to be a difficult season, but as long as you know God for yourself, as long as you know the source, as long as you know the deliverer. And I come just to share, Pastor Parks, if nobody else want to tell you just point blank today, I want you to know you can do this. Be strong and do it. Last thing I want to show you that Solomon had that I believe God sees in him, this attention to details, is His distinctiveness and his diligence and his grit that he has, his determination, but also I believe God sees in Solomon a capacity to follow the details. If you look at verse 11 and then literally 11 through verse 18, you will discover that what David hands Solomon are the plans for the whole temple. In other words, I know you're smart. I know you're going to ask for wisdom, and I know you're going to have all of that. But one thing you don't need to do is come up with some new plans. I'm going to give you the plan. I'm going to give you the pattern. I'm going to give you the doctrine. I'm going to give you the word. I'm going to give you the path. I'm going to give you what you need that will guarantee your success. All you have to do is follow the plans. Oh, yeah, it's measured out. The material already there, is already available. The skilled workers have already been signed up. The architects have already done measurements. The engineers have already done calculations. Solomon, here are the plans. And if you just follow the plan, if you just follow what I'm giving you, you will be guaranteed success. And brothers and sisters, that's all I'm trying to really tell all of us, is that God really has a plan for your life too. And all you have to do is learn how to follow the path that God has set. You see, the reality of it is we're trying to figure out things that have already been figured out. In other words, you're trying to figure out what God has already worked out. He said to Solomon, Solomon, follow the plan. Mm-hmm. And if you do it the way the Lord says do it, he guarantees your success. Oh, yeah. I'm going to close when I tell you, if you stay with the master planner, God is able to bring your plans into fruition. Oh, yeah. And I heard David saying, every day won't be a good day. No, no, every season won't be a smooth season. Yeah, but if you hold on to the pattern, all I'm trying to tell you is you can trust the planner when you run into trouble with the plans. Yes, you can. You can trust in the Lord, and when you can't find your way, just keep your eyes on the master planner. Can I get a witness? Keep your eyes on the author and the finisher of our faith. Anybody know Jesus? Jesus, my rock in a weary land. Jesus, my shelter in a time of storm. Jesus, my bridge over troubled water. He's able. Somebody say able. He's able. Able. Somebody know he's able. Have you tried him and trusted him for yourself? Can I ask you a question? Did he bring you through? Do your soul look back and wonder how you made it this far? Somebody say, nobody, nobody but Jesus. Nobody. Oh, yeah. Nobody but Jesus. It was his plan in the very beginning. It was his gospel in the very beginning. That means no matter what you do, you can work the plan. But all of the glory is going to belong to God. Is there anybody here that know that God deserves all of the glory? Say yeah. Somebody say yeah. Oh, yeah.
Delivering it. Thank you, sir. So we're going to get ready for our invitation to discipleship. Reverend Holt, there you go. Go ahead and take us to.
Good afternoon, church. I don't know about you, but I was encouraged by that word. Thank you, Dr. Hatch. I was encouraged. I'm going to pray for a little bit of grit. I don't know about the rest of you. So thank you. At this time, we're going to extend an invitation to discipleship. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, yesterday is gone. Tomorrow is not promised. Today is your presence to accept him. If you have accepted him as your Lord and Savior, and you've put your relationship with him on pause, now is the time to come back to him. He is waiting for you with his arms wide open. And the third, if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you are not connected with the church home, and you believe in your heart that this is the place that God has sent you to work out his purpose in your life, this is your opportunity. The doors of the church are open.
I suffered so long, I felt so alone, I had nowhere to go. My life was filled with pain. I didn't know what steps to take. I called on the Lord. He was there through the storm and rain. Yeah.
Through the storm and rain, I made it.
Through heartaches and pain. I've lost loved ones, and when the doctor said it couldn't be done, I had to stand on God's word. My life was still in pain. I didn't know what to take. I called on the Lord. He answered my prayer through the storm, yeah.
Through the storm and rain, I made it.
Through heartaches and pain,
I made it.
Through the storm, through the storm and
Thank you, Jesus.
And if you weren't blessed by that, amen. Amen. So I'm going to ask you guys to one more time honor our First Lady and Pastor as we ask them to come to the stage.
Good evening, church family. It's an honor for me to stand here today as part of this ceremony to honor our pastor for 1 year service. We have been blessed. Just this morning, you shared that you have touched us with love. Also, you said, well, I made it uncomfortable for you sometimes because we don't want you to get set in your ways and you start doing stuff that's ugly in the sight of God.
Amen.
So he's been had it a little uncomfortable at times. And we thank you for that, Pastor. And our former pastor, he always said to us, in order to show the love for you, always show love to the First Lady.
Amen.
And we show our love to you today, Pastor. We show your love. Thank you so much. And Josh, I know you said that you went and showed your mom how to do slides and things like that. Tell the truth. You loved it, didn't you? Showing your mom what to do. Tell the truth. Tell the truth. I just to share you just because, you know, I'm almost 71 years old. And I had to call my son over to the house just yesterday. You know, I got one of those smart TVs. And it's sometimes you're 71 years old, it's a little smarter than you are.
That's right.
So I called him over, and he got... I had all the joy in the world just to come out and just show Dad what to do. Once he walked out of there, he had the biggest smile on his face you had. So, Joyce, I know you had a smile on your face when you were doing that. So all that, Pastor, we, members of this church, just want to show you that we love you and a beacon of our love to show you the appreciation and continue to make things a little uncomfortable to us. And that way, we'll continue to go down that path that God wants us to go. Because if you start getting too comfortable, we get ugly.
That's right.
And we don't want to get ugly. Thank you, Pastor.
God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so much. What a time we've had on today. What a time. What a mighty, mighty word we've heard from this man of God. Can we celebrate him one more time? God bless you, Dr. Hatch. Amen. There's so much to say and so little time. Our hearts are just overflowing with gratitude for the love that not only this church has shown, but also that those of you who are gathered here today have shown by still staying and hanging on in there with us throughout the program. So thank you so much to everyone who stayed throughout the entire program. Thank you so very much. I give honor and praise first and foremost to God, but secondly to my co-partner and co-laborer, my lovely wife, Diane. Thank you so much for laboring, for loving, for living with your husband. Amen. Amen. I just had to throw one more L in there. I'm a preacher. I need three L's. Three. Amen. We thank God today, and I was listening to Dr. Hatt talking about grit, but I wanted some grits too, though, you know. I want them both. Amen. We're grateful to be called into service for such a time as this, and as I've said to so many of my pastor counterparts that was already pastoring before the pandemic, this is all I know. This is my normal. And so I thank God for being called into service for such a time as this, but I yet believe that God is doing a great thing in his church and in his people. And so we thank God. I'm so grateful for your presence. My baby girl is here, Ebony Joyce. Come on, wave your hand, baby. And her friend, Sean. My heart is happy just being blessed by your presence. Thank you for coming here. And we see so many people, so many of our, we call them family, Sister Michelle and Katrina. They like family to me, our sisters, Sister Gwen. God bless you. So many people that are so near and dear to Diane and I's heart. And so we're grateful. I'm grateful for the great leadership team that has surrounded me since I've gotten here. Listen, you can't have great leadership without great fellowship. So I thank God for the great members of this church who continue to pray for me and continue to encourage me as we've all made it through the storm, not just the pastor, but us as well, each of us. And so grateful. And so I don't want to hold you long. Do you want to say anything, baby?
First of all, I'd like to give honor to God, who is the head of my life. I just want to say that I am just so full, and I am just so grateful for all the people of God. I know you're praying for me, and I'm praying for you. And I just want to give special thanks to two women in this ministry. I'm not going to call their name, but it's times that I have to call them and say, I need a prayer. And I need you guys to pray with me, because it's not easy on this journey, seeing him have to be away from the home, preaching and teaching and doing the things of God. But I knew one day that I would have to give this up and give him to the people of God. But long as he served Jesus, I'm on that road with him. And keep praying for me and loving me, and I'll love you. Thank you.
Amen. So before we turn it over to Reverend Holt to give the benediction, I want to make sure that I thank the music ministry. Thank you so much to the music ministry and to the choir. They sang so wonderfully. They encouraged my heart in a tremendous way. And to the wonderful pastoral committee, come on, let's give them a hand. They had so much attention to detail, so concerned about what I liked and what would make me happy. And so they absolutely positively knocked it out of the park. To all of our ministers at SBC, I know we acknowledged you already, but I thank God for you surrounding me, encouraging me, and then standing in the gap when we need a word delivered. I see all of you around the house. And then I see all of the pastors, the fellow pastors that are here today. I love you all. I see my big brother, Marcus Wilson, and I see my brother from Chicago. To make that trip all the way out here to encourage me, it's just been a wonderful, wonderful evening. And so I thank you so much. I told him we got 1 year down and eternity to go. Let's continue to work together and watch what God will do. Amen. God bless you.
Once again, on behalf of our pastor and First Lady, we thank each and every one of you for your presence. You know, this is the day that the Lord has made. We did rejoice, and we were certainly glad in it. So can we just give the Lord a round of applause? Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you will do, Lord Jesus. So I say right now, Lord Jesus, by the grace of God, by the love of Jesus Christ, and by the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, may you rest, rule, and abide in each and every one of us, henceforth and forevermore. Let every heart under the sound of my voice join me in saying amen, amen, and amen again. Thank you.
All right. Hopefully you got.
We thank you for worshiping with us today. And if you're looking to connect with a loving church that faithfully teaches God's message of hope, then visit our website at sbcelginil.org and follow the link that says Join Our Church. We hope to see you soon at the Second Baptist Church of Elgin, where we live and learn God's Word together.